you go dry when the COVID's ripping through the country. Let's be realistic. It's like,
exactly.
That's why FDR gave him the right to drink again. Remember? First thing he did when he took office.
Well, I wasn't alive when FDR was president, so therefore, but neither were you.
Neither was I, let me tell you. But I just, okay. I'm a big fan of history.
You're a
historian,
yeah. Yes. So, yeah, I mean, it's an occasionally dry January. I'm trying out a few little mocktails, but this was like a leftover bottle of wine that was pre-Christmas, and somebody had to drink it. It might as well have been me.
That's correct. Right. Waste is a sin. Can't let that go.
Exactly. Waste not, want not, drink nor, Eden. So that's where I ended up. But it's good. It's just a simple little Chardonnay. Nobody else is going to like it anyway, so.
And if I drank it, it would taste like toothpaste and orange juice right now. I got to tell you.
I'm so sorry that you've lost your sense of taste. Maybe lost smell too, or just taste?
No, I've got smell and taste. It's just things don't taste right. And then alcohol tastes like rubbing alcohol. It's like the worst punishment in the world, but it will help me keep dry in January. That's for
sure. This is true. This is true. I'll drink everything you can't, and then we'll do a little taste test and get your taste buds back up and running.
Are we on? I thought we were going to start the year on time. Play me in. Live from Studio One in the Steel Cow Building, located in historic Wakefield, Rhode Island, home of Johnny Cakes and Brisley's Ice Cream. This is The Eden Show, a Greenhouse Entertainment Group production, and I'm Dan Chaika. Eden's guest tonight is the marvelous Daniel Shigo, who will be playing Songs Like a Song with our fearless leader, the one, the only, Miss Eden Casteel.
Singer, songwriter, producer, whatever, based in Wakefield, Rhode Island. I help people make their musical dreams come true. And Happy New Year to all of you out there watching. Please let us know where you're watching from in the chat. We'd love to hear from you. Thank you for being part of this and for coming back and joining us in the new year, 2022.
Good riddance. I thought 2020 was a good year to get rid of. Let's just get rid of 2021 too. I mean, except for the fact that we did have a live performance, release a couple of videos, have an album. So 2021 was pretty good too, actually.
Yeah, except for that, it sucked, right? Yeah.
Yeah, it did.
Maybe this time I'll be lucky. Maybe this time I won't get COVID. Maybe this time people won't lose their minds over scientific facts. Okay, maybe not. It was worth a shot. I'm trying to start the year positively because we ended with a bang. Dan, what happened to you over the break?
I caught the corona light.
He caught the corona light, but he is still here. Yay!
Yes. Double vax, super cautious, masked, gloved, everything. And that incredibly pesky Omicron worked its way into my nose. There's nothing I could do about it.
Who do we blame? Who can we
anybody? Who do we blame? all those friggin' people that I saw during the Christmas period who wore their masks below their nose, didn't wear a mask, claimed it was no big deal, called it a friggin' liberal hoax. You know, let's be realistic. Mm-hmm. It's just
you were just so careful. I know you were. And it wasn't because you weren't careful. It just really is a really tough variant. So you said the way that you noticed was you were having a small bit of alcohol.
Oh.
Yeah, so, tell the story.
So, you know, I didn't quite lose my sense of taste. And I kept ripping open clementines to make sure I could smell them and biting into them to make sure I could taste them. And that was all fine until I opened up a 10-year-old bottle of amazing Italian Barolo that should have been like drinking velvet. And I poured a glass for me and I poured a glass for Mel and I took my first sip and it was like drinking orange juice after brushing your teeth. And I looked at Mel and said, "Oh my God, is this bottle horrible?" And she said, "No, it's absolutely wonderful. Here, let me drink yours."
And that was the symptom.
You
were sick for a few days in bed, but now you're kind of
coming. I had three incredibly miserable days and nights. And then it's been another 6 days since then, 7 days today since then, of incredible fatigue, sore. My eyeballs were so sore. Like, it hurt to use my eyes. That's how sore I was. It was just miserable.
I'm so sorry.
But
glad.
I will say there was never a time where I was afraid I was going to suffocate to death and not make it through. It was just...
That's worth a cheer.
It sure is. I had the flu in 2019. I tell you, it hit me much harder. But then again, that's why we joke about this being Corona light, because it is, you know, the Delta virus took out my business partner 2 weeks ago and she was near death. It was miserable for her. And I know people are still dying at the rate of about 1,400 Americans a day. So it's no joke. It's no joke, but it's certainly not. And I think they've gotten better at, you know, at least now when you call the doctor, they tell you what to do. They put me on some secondary antibiotics because I have some respiratory issues. You know what the signs are. You have this confidence that at least now they know how to fight it.
That's great.
You know, when you and I wrote the song that we're going to play for people a little later on.
Middle of the show.
It was, you caught it and there was a good chance you were dying because there was nothing they could do in the hospital except roll you around on your belly and hope that that helped you breathe until you could get through it. It was, it's definitely, you know, medical science is as adaptive as everything else. And they've really made great strides, which is why could you all get vaccinated and keep our ERs not crowded? The doctor sent me to the ER that first day I was really sick because he took a look at all my comorbidities. Mm-hmm. You can't tell on this beautiful screen, but I am obese. I have asthma. I have high blood pressure and I'm a diabetic. And he literally sent me to the ER and I go to the Miriam Hospital in my neighborhood and there are at least a dozen ambulances. Four of them couldn't even make it into the parking lot. They're lined up on the street, like with the sirens going, waiting for room to get in. And I go to walk into the emergency room and it was more crowded than the floor at a Grateful Dead show. It was unbelievable. And I looked around at all these sick people coughing and sneezing and decided I will go home because it's safer than being here.
And that's where you went and that's where you stayed. And I am so, so glad that you were okay. So now because really I was thinking the whole time, well, I don't want to find another MC.
I appreciate that.
I mean, priorities, Dan. And
I was,
yeah.
So, yeah. I was so thrilled. I'm like, I will be back in time for this show. I will be back by the 6th.
And so, because you're back, I want you to, I'm going to do all of the on this days. I want you to deliver the punchlines.
We're going to try. Okay. We're going to try.
It's a two Dan show tonight.
Yes.
Two Dan show. There's a Dan and a Daniel.
Yes.
But, so we're going to do the two Dan high. See?
I got
two Dan's
it.
High. On this day, January 6th, in 1681, I'm going to start like chronologically, okay?
Okay, gotcha.
Chronologically, in 1681, the first recorded boxing match was engineered by Christopher Monk, 2nd Duke of Albemarle. It was his butler versus his butcher.
And of course, my money was on the butcher because the butcher always knows how to do an uppercut.
I still don't have a rim shot. I need a rim
What
shot.
The heck?
I know. Restream doesn't have rim shots easily available. Okay. On this day, in 1838, Samuel Morse demonstrated the telegraph for the first time in Morristown, New Jersey.
Or as the kids might say today, some guy just texted me. I like that joke.
Thank you. It's terrible. On this day in 1907, Maria Montessori opened her first school in Rome.
And when the school was over, she carefully put all the parts back where they belonged.
Did you ever take, were you a Montessori kid? I had a Montessori kid.
Oh, no.
Okay. No. All right. It makes sense. If you have kids in Montessori, if you went to Montessori, it totally makes sense. Otherwise,
I am aware of Montessori, and I'm aware of everybody having to pick up their stuff at the end of the day.
So. Okay. So the one person watching out of the 10 who are watching right now, it's a Montessori joke. It's very funny. You got it. In 1963, the musical Oliver opened in New York.
And after the first performance, the audience said, "Please, sir, may I have some more?"
Okay. I know. That was a really bad one. That's really groany. But that's what we do. We groan. And on this day, January 6th, 2022, Daniel Shigo is a guest on The Eden Show.
Volume 38. Dirty 30s.
Hi, Daniel Shigo.
Hello from New York City.
It is so good to see you.
Nice to see you, too.
Yeah, I'll take off all of this stuff so everybody can see your pretty face. So, Daniel, it's an all Sondheim show we're going to do, right?
It certainly is.
Yes, we're going to honor the man. So, Dan Chaika, I'm going to put you in the green room, and I'm going to make Daniel Shigo sing!
Yes.
All right, you keep healthy. You go take some monoclonal antibodies. I'll talk to you soon. All right, Daniel Shigo, I'm so excited I get to play all these for you, and really excited that you get to sing them, and I just have to play them. So,
you have the harder job.
I got the harder job, and I've got my trusty four score here, or whatever. So, have fun. Good luck with the latency. We're going to have fun. This is from Anyone Can Whistle.
Everybody says don't. Everybody says don't. It isn't right. Don't. It isn't nice. Everybody says don't. Everybody says don't walk on the grass. Don't disturb the peace. Don't skate on the ice. Well, I say do. I say walk with the rest of the men to feel. I say. Tilt to the windmill, and if you fail, you fail. Everybody says don't. Everybody says don't get out of line. When they say that, then, lady, that's a sign. 9 times out of 10, you are doing just fine.
That's what I like to hear. We're doing just fine.
Just make a ripple. Come on, be brave. This time a ripple. Next time a wave. Sometimes I have to start small, climbing the tiniest wall. Maybe you're going to fall, but it's better than not starting at all. Everybody says no, everybody says stop, everybody says mustn't rock the boat, mustn't touch a thing. Everybody says don't, everybody says wait, everybody says can't fight City Hall, can't upset the cart, can't laugh at the king. I say try, I say laugh at the kings will make you cry. Lose your poise, fall if you have to, but lady, make a noise. Everybody says don't, everybody says can't, everybody says wait around for miracles. That's the way the world is made. I insist on miracles, if you do them, miracles, nothing to them. I say don't. That kind of worked.
True words never said. That kind of worked. Absolutely, it kind of worked. And my stepdaughter just texted me in the middle of it as well. Okay.
Yes. And what did you say?
I'm going to hang out with my friend Gus at Old Mountain Field. I'm going to drive him home at 9 at the latest. So, viewers, we'll see who she is. Okay, good. Oh, Ellen Betancourt says hello.
Hello, Ellen Betancourt.
Is that a friend of yours?
Yes, she's from SECO, I believe.
Oh, that's right. Ellen. Okay, let me see if I can get this on here. I don't know if I can get the comments on here. There's that one from NK. My friend Terry Shea is watching, but I don't know if I can get Ellen's on here because it's a pretty little flower thing. Thank you, Ellen. I appreciate that. So, okay, Daniel Chaika says that absolutely worked. Woo! All right. If the MC says it worked, it worked. So it's hard to do that kind of stuff fast, which is why we started that right at the top of the hour.
Yeah.
I thought, well, if it all screws up, at least we got one done. Right?
Yes.
So you and I both love Sondheim so much.
Yes.
So you've been.
And I rubbed shoulders with him once.
Tell me how that happened.
Well, we were doing Sweeney Todd at City Opera, which, you know, he would say it's an opera if it's an opera house, it's a musical if it's a musical, you know. And he was always about the words, not so much the tone. But I had a solo in the last line, in the second act. And he never said anything to me. But I repeatedly passed him going from the stage out to the house, and he was coming back to give Elaine Page notes or somebody. And I literally was rubbing shoulders with him like 4 or 5 times, and he's shorter, and I'd be like, oh, each time. It's cool.
And isn't it that if he didn't give you notes, that was a good thing?
I hope.
Like, Patty Cindy Lapone mentioned that she got a few notes from him, but it was addiction related because she knows she has addiction, right? So, so maybe that's good. It's good to rub shoulders with him, but also to have him never contact you otherwise.
Yeah. So he was there at the final address, I remember, and he spoke to the whole cast. I can't remember exactly what he said, but he said something like, "You know, just go out there and kill him." It was interesting. It was just an interesting experience to be around that, you know?
Did the whole atmosphere in the place change when you knew he was in the house?
I don't know. I was younger then. I don't know. But there's always somebody famous hanging around an opera house, you know, a composer or somebody there, someone in the cast, you know.
Your opera houses. And where did you sing, speaking of? Now,
I sang mainly at City Opera, New York City Opera, from 1988 to 2011. And for about 8 years there, I also sang at the Met. 1 year full time, pretty much. So I had a grand time. I'm sort of retired from that now, but I'm teaching. I'm mainly a teacher, but it was fun. I just lucked into it. I totally lucked into it. May I tell the short story?
Yes, please.
Wonderful friend named Musetta. I won't say her last name. She may not want it said. It said, she worked at the Guild at City Opera, and she said, "You should come audition. They're having auditions, da, da, da." I was living out in New Jersey, and so I called them up. It was like a Thursday, and they said, "Yeah, we're having auditions. Today is the last day. We have an opening at like 12:30. And so I literally got in the car, drove to the train station, had a 45-minute train ride, got there, warmed up, and then I sang for Joe Collinari, then the chorus master, who's now at the Met, I think. And he said, "Can you come back next week and sing for Donald Hazard?" Who I didn't know who that was. And that was the right hand of Beverly Sills. And I sang for Donald Hazard. He said, "Can you sing for Beverly Sills?" And so I did on the stage. And they, by the time I got home, I took the train from that third audition, I knew I had a job there. So.
Bubbles.
Yeah, it just was totally luck. Absolute luck, you know. So they say preparation and, you know, opportunity meet. Mm-hmm. You know, so
it was really lucky you also had your five arias absolutely ready to go, right?
I sang one.
Just, yeah, one of the five.
I sang one of two.
Oh, my God. I hate you.
I sang one of two. I sang Non più andrai. They didn't want to hear German. I'm the luckiest guy in the world.
You are the luckiest guy.
I was very lucky.
So, viewers who are watching, when you're an opera singer, you know, trying out for a company or something, you're generally having your book five arias, right?
Or eight, even.
Yeah, and different languages, different styles, things like that. Sorry, that's my Facebook going twink twink. So you have to have that ready to go. You have to have the perfect audition outfit. You got to go and stand in line. You know, you're doing a whole bunch of cattle calls and things like that. At least that was the system in the 90s, right?
Yes. 2000s. Yes.
So, but yeah, you basically, you had a Cinderella experience.
I did. And it was interesting too, because I was filling in for someone who was taking a leave, mm-hmm. who actually, and then I had to re-audition like later when he actually did leave. But what's interesting is that when I had my first costume fitting for, like, you know, there was like 20 shows and I had a costume fitting for 16, and the head of costume said, "The only reason you got this job is because you fit the costume," which is actually partially true. They didn't have to spend money changing stuff. That's part of the deal. I tell people that, you know.
It is true. And, you know, I mean, as much as you want to think that kind of stuff doesn't matter, it does. I once got cast in something where they had a different guy as the leading man, but once they cast me, they cast somebody older to match me since I was older. Because otherwise I would have been a cougar and they didn't actually want a cougar. So that's the only time that's ever happened to me where they actually recast a guy for me.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, I wore as much moisturizer as I could, so we met in the middle. But hey, so it happens, and you know, it's the reality of the business, and it happens in Sondheim as well as in opera. And you and I are both former opera singers, recovering opera singers, who can still do it and still love it. But we also love Sondheim because he's so close to that, right? What would you say is the why do opera singers love Sondheim so much?
Well, I think probably Sweeney Todd is the one opera that or show that sort of, because it's a gothic story, mm-hmm. and it's scary, It's
Mrs. Lovett, by the way.
Oh, that's so fabulous.
Thank you.
So fabulous.
I just have that up there on Restream because I'm so glad you mentioned that.
And I listened, we had this talk earlier. I listened to you sing that. You sent me a link, and you're a coloratura soprano, and what you do with that is effing amazing.
Thank you.
It really is, because that's not easy.
It was fun to be like totally in a different voice part, right?
Well,
comparatively. So, but yeah, it's such good language. And that particular one is now done by opera companies, right?
Yes.
Stephen Blythe does it and everything. But yet he called it a dark operetta.
Yeah.
Right? So, but the one you're going to do next is actually from Saturday Night. Is that right?
I think so, yes. This is not a show I've seen. And this is a duet in the show, kind of.
Right.
And we're just doing just a bit of it.
Right. Okay. So,
this is so many people.
All right, you're starting from the chorus, right?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Yeah. So I'll give you a little bit of an intro here. Remember, if anything goes wrong, you just keep on singing.
So many people in the world, and what can they do? They'll never know love like my love for you. So many people laugh at what they don't know, but that's their concern. If just a few, say half a million or so, could see us, they'd learn. So many people in the world don't know what they've missed. They'd never believe such joy could exist. And if they tell us it's a thing we'll outgrow, they're jealous as they can be, that with so many people in the world, you love me. I tried out that I know thing. I don't know if that worked, but
he's not here to tell you not to do that. So yeah.
There's one reason I really love that song, and it's a technical singer thing, and it's a thing that people don't do anymore, because you get to sing that with so instead of with so, that with so many. It joins the words lovely.
You're right. That with so many. Yeah.
You don't hear that much anymore.
Yeah. Oh, look,
Judy Garland did it.
She did?
Yeah. A lot of them did that.
And what? I mean, that kind of connecting that shadow.
Yes, that with so many people.
That's just good song style. Somebody saying hi to you from Hong Kong.
I know who that is.
Liang Hui Chui.
Yes.
Is that right?
Liang Hui. Yeah.
That's beautiful.
Yes, someone up is up very early.
Very early. Thank you so much.
It's tomorrow there.
Tomorrow. I love you. Tomorrow. And Larry says hi. All of your friends are saying hi.
Hello, Mr. Larry.
This is great.
And there's Shirley.
There's Shirley. Yes, thank you so much for checking in and supporting Daniel tonight. We really, really appreciate it. So you've been teaching in the city for a while, right?
I've been teaching a long, long time. But I'm teaching in the city. And mostly, of course, we're all online now. And that's really kind of cool. I actually love that. That's not just a promo. I wrote a... I wrote a blog. I have a blog on my website.
ShagoVoiceLessons.com.
I have a blog. I have a blog. I've had it for like 10 years. It used to be on Google. It's now on my website. And I wrote this blog called Online is the 18th Century. Because in the 18th century, you had no help. You had nobody playing nice chords for you. You actually just had to show up and like sing this. You had to sing. Uh-huh. And you get it that way a lot faster. So... online is really kind of like that. There's like no barrier. I mean, of course, there's a technical barrier, but there's no fluff. You just have to get this thing.
Right. And just get down to business if you're willing to.
Exactly. So it works. It actually works. So, I mean, I have my coloratura soprano in Hong Kong, you know, in her second year, and she's really doing this thing. So it's possible.
That's so great.
Yeah.
She's like the walking advertisement of why this works.
Well, it does work.
It really does. And it doesn't, I mean, a shameless plug, right? You can work with me if you want to learn how to do this kind of live streaming, whether you're a performer or an instructor. But it really does work. So tonight we are just using live, a restream, as our connector. So yes, there's a little bit of a delay, but the music that Daniel chose works fine with this, so we can manage. But we, earlier in the week, we always test with the guest, and we did test out some of the low latency audio. We tested Sonobus, and that worked really well as well. But putting those two together, a really good live stream and a really good audio, getting them to work together is the tough part. So tonight we decided just to go with Restream, but you know, when you come back and do this show again, we might try something else. So that's the great thing about it. So, but I love this. I mean, there's COVID all around us, and my sweet, you know, MC is recovering, but we can still have a show, and he can participate too, which is so fun. Gary says hi.
Yes, yes, yes. How are you, mister?
This is so cool. And Jeff says hi.
Oh, Jeff. Jeff, you should be on here. Gary, you both be on here.
Yeah, Jeff. You should be on this show.
So. If this old guy can do it, you can.
Yeah, you ain't that old.
I'm 63.
You're 63. You don't look a day over 61, Daniel.
It's the formaldehyde.
It's so good. You're right. Well preserved. Well preserved. Hey, you're doing great. You're absolutely. Tell me about your famous relations. You were name dropping earlier that you're not the most famous Shigo in the Shigo family.
I am not. My last name is Hungarian, and I have a very famous uncle named Alex Shigo, who unfortunately is deceased. In my first gig here in New York, I was singing out in Brooklyn, and they're going around the room introducing, and I said my name, and then the next guy next to me, we're in the bass section, says, "Is your father Alex Shigo?" And I said, "No, that's my uncle." And he said, "My father, who works for the Central Park Conservancy, adores him." Well, Alex Shigo is considered the father of modern arborology, the care of trees. He totally changed how trees are cared for. He worked for the Forestry Service and everything. And he even invented a instrument to detect disease in trees. It's called the shigometer. I'm not making that up. Yeah.
Okay, everybody go to Home Depot and see if you can find a shigometer.
Well, I don't know if you can find it there, but it used to have to kill the patient to figure out what was wrong with the tree. You would have to cut off the limb and like look inside. And he figured out a way to drill a hole and put a piece of copper wire through it and then send an electrical signal, and the impedance and all that would tell you what the disease was in the tree. It's interesting. I mean, and he did this like 30 years ago.
Dan Chaika, get on Google and see if you can look up a shigometer. I'm just curious. Okay. That's awesome.
I mean, the guy has a Wikipedia page, okay? So.
And someday you shall too, right? If you're lucky, right? Yeah.
Well, anybody can do that, but, you know, you got to earn it.
This is true. And, you know, and hopefully not by being a serial killer. That's all. I was thrilled that you actually interviewed the woman who my mother was named for. My mother's name Risa, named for Risa Stevens, the mezzo-soprano.
Yes, I did interview her because I'm into historical vocal pedagogy. If you go to my website, there's a page there you can join. I've got like 150 some texts there you can look at. I mean, I'm seriously into that stuff. So, and she studied with a very important teacher, and I wanted to talk to her about it. So I called her up. Her husband was ill at the time, so I didn't meet her face-to-face, but we talked a long time on the phone, and she was very, very generous.
Yeah. So I've heard that about her.
Yeah, another person like that was Kitty Carlisle Hart, who also studied with the same teacher. She was very generous. And I went to her apartment on Madison and 64th Street, and that was very interesting. So.
And she was only married to Moss for a little while, right? Because he died really young. Her husband, Moss Hart?
Yeah, there's a book about him. I haven't read it, actually. But
I read it. It's fantastic.
Is it?
Yeah. So. Okay, when we do book club on the Eden Show, we'll talk about Moss Hart's book. And it was supposed to be like volume one, right?
Yeah.
And he wrote it about his growing up. He grew up in abject poverty. And then just little by little. And there were so many times where he just slipped back down into poverty. But he kept clawing and clawing and clawing. And so finally he started working with Kaufman on You Can't Take It With You. And finally got better. But it is such a great story of how hard he worked.
Yeah,
and it was only about when he first finally got successful enough that he was able to move his parents into a house where they could actually survive. That was the end of the first book, because he obviously intended to write another one, and then he didn't live that long. So, but it is such a great story about just like American grit, gumption, and talent out of his pores. So, yeah, highly recommend.
You know, I first met Katie Carlisle Hart before I actually interviewed her, because I was in a, I was in the show he wrote the book for, Lady in the Dark.
Oh.
And she came and was dressed to the nines, and she was 90 at the time and looked like she was 60. And I mean, like a very young 60.
She was really looked youthful her whole life, didn't she?
Yeah, she was extraordinary. She was really extraordinary person.
Oh, yeah. Oh, somebody is writing something here about, oh, yeah. We talk about Moss Hart. They all have something.
That's
say.
Interesting.
Paula Goldberg. Yeah. What did she say here? You used to say at Michael's grandparents'
wow.
we didn't have subway fare. Yes.
Wow.
Which was often, apparently. He had to walk all the way through it. And his first job, he would play hooky from his job just to go down to Times Square.
Huh.
Because he wanted to be in that atmosphere, and he didn't want to be doing the job he was doing.
Hmm.
It's such a wonderful book. It will make you dream big when you read that book. So, especially for people who live in New York, I think it's just a wonderful, you know, Valentine for New York. So, highly recommend. All right, so you guys, say one more thing for me right before I let you have a break, my friend.
Okay.
So, what should we say? How about something from Sweeney Todd?
Okay.
So, why did you choose this? I mean, did you ever play this part?
No, I did not. And it's usually done by a tenor. So, but this is a lovely song.
Yeah.
So, Joanna.
This is Joanna. And this is normally done by, yeah, Anthony, right? Anthony Hope.
It's usually done by a tenor or a lighter baritone, yeah.
And we haven't done ever this before, so I look forward to hearing you do this, man.
I feel you, Joanna. I feel. I was half convinced I'd wake and satisfied enough to dream you. Happily, I was mistaken, Joanna. I'll steal you, Joanna. Steal you. Do they think that walls can hide you? Even now I'm at your window. I am in the dark beside you, sweetly buried in your yellow hair.
You're a pretty good tenor.
The first teacher who actually taught me a lot said, when she first heard me, she said, "You're a low baritone." And I thought, is that that could mean something else.
We could do a whole other show about Fach.
You want to Fach with me.
Yeah,
I mean,
with me.
I couldn't resist. I'm sorry.
Boys and girls, we're not really swearing, but we are. So Fach,
yeah.
Daniel, explain what Fach is to the layperson. What is Fach?
Well, it's, you know, the Germans developed this sort of system where the timbre of your voice, it has to do with timbre more than range even. The sound of your voice, the character of your voice has everything to do with the characters that you're singing on the stage. And so you're put in a particular position where you sing through all the roles that are associated with your Fach. So it's a restrictive but also a very simple thing. Right. So
if you stay within your Fach, basically yes. you're going to sing healthily and it's not going to be a problem.
Yes. And there are some people who are Zwischen Fach. They like go all over, like Jesse Norman
right.
did that. And, you know, other people have done that. So it's interesting. It's helpful.
It's helpful. Do you think the Fach system still exists?
Yes, of course it does. Okay. Yes, of course it does. Yeah. I don't know. It does, I think, more in Europe than it does here. But I mean, what do I know? I think we're living in a different time, too. I mean, the opera world has changed even since I was very active in it, which was a little more than a decade ago. So it's just that's a whole thing, too. So,
yeah, that's we'll have like, you know, Eden Show after hours where all we do is drink and bitch.
No, not even bitch, but it's just, you know, change is part of life. It's just that I think it's a musical thing. I think some traditions are being lost, and that's an unfortunate thing. I think people now, because there's so much media, there's no place to go anywhere and fail. And that used to be possible. And at the beginning of a career, you would go off and fail somewhere, and nobody would hear about it. Now everything is everywhere, and people are afraid to fail, and they're too concerned with being perfect. And I think that's a problem.
That's why my live stream show exists. You can fail here as much as you want.
And no one's going to see it.
And nobody's going to see it. I mean, really. I mean, it's just, yeah, those are phantom 16 people right now. Thank you, 16 people. By the way, please subscribe to my channel while you're at it. If you'd like, and if you really, really like me, you can buy me a coffee at buymeacoffee.com right up there. So that gives me a nice little tip, and we just love you for that. So, but yeah, you're right. I remember being in Germany or Austria doing a summer program. And yeah, we thrive on failure. And them talking to me about, you know, what Fach I was. And he thought I was singing too heavy. But then the American teacher said, but in America, we don't sing, you know, 30 weeks out of a year. So you can get away with singing heavier in America because you get more of a break.
That's possible. But then, you know, you realize those old singers around 1905, 1920, they were singing 4 or 5 times a week.
Because they sang in the right Fach. And they sang a lighter Fach.
It was just amazing the stuff they did. Wow. You look at this and you go, wow.
Yeah. So she was making me feel better because I was in tears. And because, you know, that's what opera does to you is it makes you cry. So sometimes on stage, sometimes in your lessons. That's our job. Anyway, that's a whole other story. Well, we can tell real stories sometime. All right, so now, Daniel Shigo, I'm going to give you a break for a little bit. I'm going to bring the other Dan in here. Yeah. Okay, Dan, did you find a shigometer?
I emailed you 2 pictures, 1 black and white, the original model, and a color, more modern model.
I'm so happy. All right, so it exists, a shigometer. Is it available at a Home Depot?
No, but someone's selling one used, but I had to log on. I couldn't see what they wanted for it.
Can I put it on a Christmas tree?
They're selling a model OZ something. It was an original shigometer versus a more modern one. But
Daniel, did your relative patent this? Like the shigometer?
Probably.
Literally says shigometer on the front of the new ones. Yeah.
I don't have one. I don't need one. I mean, you have to know what to do with the thing, right?
Yeah. Well,
I'm wondering if you could tweak it a little and actually listen to the trees sing.
Oh.
Wouldn't that be awesome?
My uncle called maple syrup the blood of trees. Mm. It was really funny, actually.
Mommy, may I have the blood of trees on top of my pancakes? Yeah, that's good. That's good.
He was something else.
Yeah, it sounds like it.
He was.
Right, Daniel, I'm going to put you into the green room, have a little break, and we'll be back with you in a few minutes. All right, Dan Chaika. My COVID recovering friend. I am so glad that you're recovering from COVID.
Yeah, I just want to pick up on what he was saying, which is the fact that because of the internet, people are much more afraid of failing.
Yeah.
But it's too bad because the internet should be a place where, let's be realistic, there's such much crap out there. Everybody's trying. And I think that we get a lot of good stuff. I mean, I'll scan through the Facebook reels or the YouTube, whatever. And some of the stuff is awesome.
Volume 38.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Why did we start doing this show? Why did we start doing this show? We did it almost
because of COVID.
Because of COVID. And our year anniversary is actually coming up this month.
Yes.
But we did it because we were looking for something to do to keep performing in the midst of this horrible pandemic. And who would have thought a year later we would still be doing it exactly like this? But I love doing this show, right?
And if you're afraid of failure, if everybody's afraid of failure, we're going to end up with just crap. Just stuff that people do by rote that's cookie cutter and formulaic. And you know what? You got to break a few eggs if you're going to make an omelet, right? And
that's exactly right.
I love the fact that we're able to do this, right? That, you know, and I mean, we got someone from Hong Kong. They take the cake. That's as far away as I thought Austria and playing personal Jesus with a couple of bass players in Austria. I thought that was it. You know, I really was like, that's a rate. But now we're reaching all the way to Hong Kong. Yeah.
Daniel teaches her in Hong Kong. Isn't that awesome?
That is awesome.
It is awesome. So speaking of awesome, I think we have, let's see if I get this graphic up here because it's an awesome graphic. I worked my butt off on this graphic. There it is. Shameless plugs, shameless plugs. If this virus was ending, I know you'd be attending. Shameless plugs.
Right, I know we had to postpone the live karaoke, which is a personal favorite of mine and my friends. We really are enjoying that stuff. I got to tell you.
I was bummed.
Yes.
So we were supposed to have it this Sunday. It's going to be Sunday, February 13th instead. We're going to take this month off, and that way everybody is safe. So we will see you at the Pump House on Sunday, February 13th. Mm. And we'll hope. Actually, I already had people emailing me like, I'm so excited this Sunday. I'm bringing this song and this song. And I just, I'm so sorry. I can't do
it.
But that was a good choice. I was at the right call. It's just not safe enough in Rhode Island to do that. So, unfortunately.
Yeah, we don't want to be a super spreader, you know.
Right. Yeah. Only want to spread joy.
And we don't want to kill off any of our 16 fans. Let's be realistic.
Exactly. We want you all to be alive for the next Eden show. So, the co-eds are going to be performing, me and my friend Ed Valley. So, we're going to be doing a performance over at the Charlestown Rathskeller on Friday, January 14th, 9 to 11 p.m. for those night owls. And so there's information about that. And Ed has been working really hard on our website.
Oh, cool.
Oh, yeah. And we're really excited about that. And then we're also going to be at Java Madness in Wakefield at the end of January. So those are two things that are coming up. And Ed is great about the tech. So we sometimes rehearse online together, and we sometimes live stream. It's really fun.
I mean, it's nice when you guys have Marty and you add the third co-ed and you do the bass. But I got to say, the guitar and the piano, they're like chocolate and peanut butter. They are two great sounds that go well together.
Okay,
and as a matter of fact, right before I caught COVID, I saw, Duke Robillard had just a pianist with him, a keyboard player, an old hippie from Country Joe and the Fish, who he'd never played before. They met online, and he invited him to come down to Nicanese, and the two of them played Cold Turkey for 3 hours, and it was... I've sat there saying, you know what? That's all co-eds. That's you guys. I mean, it's just literally keyboard, guitar, vocal. All you really need.
Kismet. Yeah. I love that.
No offense, Joe. No offense, Marty. We do love a strong rhythm section.
We do.
But if you don't got it, you don't got it. You can get away with just some keys and a guitar player.
Well, here's actually a picture of me earlier today. I was actually recording with Joe, Gino, Chris and Eric up in Eric's studio in Providence. So I was recording with Evening Sky, and my son was my wingman because I wanted him to see what it was like. So I don't know if this picture will, that's the co-eds. But I have a little video of this because I'm getting better at putting video on. So this is me singing earlier today, and talk about not being afraid of failure. There it is.
Careful if you try.
That's all you get.
Did you see all those instruments packed into all those shelves?
That's in a secure, undisclosed location that nobody will ever know the address of.
No, it's thrilling. It's just thrilling to see all that stuff.
It's such a cool place. So it's a converted garage into a studio. And of course, those players are so awesome. They're the members of Evening Sky, Eric, Joe, Gino, and Chris. And so it was the first time I rehearsed with them today. So I'm going to be recording with them sometime this winter. So we're just kind of getting our songs in order. It's really exciting.
Your friend Laura picked up on the theme. We need to do a show about not being perfect.
Oh, dear. I think we could do that. Remember when she was on and she did Mrs. Laura's Nest and how fun that was? Okay. I think, Laura, really, every show we do is about not being perfect, if you think about it. But yes.
Have you not seen The Open?
Yes.
We haven't nailed it yet.
So, but it's true. It's true. And this is a place where I want people to feel free to come and try stuff out. And because when you get in front of the actual audience, as you well know, things change. Yeah. But it's fun to try it in this kind of, you know, sort of low stress environment. So, Dan, there was a thing we did when you – was it when you were exposed to COVID but you didn't have it yet?
Yes.
And
yes.
That was
so
a year ago, right?
Before there was a vaccine and when we were all really, people were getting it, were dropping like flies, I was forced to go into in-person court, which we hadn't had in a long time. Mm-hmm. And I had to spend 3 hours in close quarters with a colleague I'd known for 30 years who didn't believe in COVID and was a absolute denier and was insistent on not wearing a mask. And, you know, ultimately that was on a Friday afternoon, 3 hours. And by Monday morning, he was in the ICU, spent 42 days on a respirator and friggin' died. Just traumatic, quite a traumatic event. And I called Eden up on, actually, I think we had a lesson on Monday. Mm-hmm. But for some reason, I'm on the phone with Eden and I'm telling Eden about what happened. And I'm waiting for a call from the Department of Health. They're booking me for an appointment for a test and they're getting all my contact, when they were diligent, all my contact tracing information. And Eden's like, let's write a song about it. And we started to think about just the concepts we were going to do for the song, and the unknown number comes in from the Department of Health. So I'm like, Eden, I got to go. And I spend 15 minutes on the phone with the contact tracing people and everything else. And I get back and Eden's like, we're going to do it to It Could Happen to You. Do you know that song? And I'm like, of course I know that song. I know the original song. I know the song from the Gold Digger movie. And I know the song from like when Art Garfunkel redid it. Right. Mm-hmm. And, Eden and I wrote the song in a half a flip an hour, literally a half an hour. Mm-hmm. And it took a lot longer to shoot the video and to put it together. But it was quite, Eden was quarantined. Her son had exposed her accidentally. Mm-hmm. And both of us were stuck at home. And that's what, this is folks, another shameless plug. This is why you should be going on Eden's website and filling out a questionnaire. She's starting the year off right. Mm-hmm. But Eden deals with everything by writing a flipping song about it. That is just, you're going to see it later on. Matter of fact, as soon as I get off the screen, her and Daniel are going to write songs for you, as that's the highlight of the show for everybody. Yes. They don't think it is until they've done it, but that's how Eden deals with it. And we came up with this wonderful little ditty. And
are you ready?
I gotta say, my lovely girlfriend had to shoot the video because unfortunately we couldn't get Eden in to do it.
No, we did it completely quarantined. Everything we did was done safely.
And
I wish that this still wasn't apropos, but it's still apropos. So I think in your honor of surviving COVID, we run the video again. Are you ready?
Let's. All right. I love this. It's adorable.
All right. If the sound doesn't work, text in there, but I think the sound's gonna work.
Like a bolt from the blue, it can happen to you. You test positive.
You test positive.
When you listen to fools who ignore all the rules, you'll test positive.
You'll test positive.
You say you won't mask because it gives you the hype. Every time that you cough, you risk all of our lives. And it gets more depressing with each passing day. And the virus is either in your nose or on its way. Don't you know that it's worth every treasure on earth to stay negative? For as rich as you are, it's much better by far to stay negative.
Negative.
When your test news comes back and you're shocked and surprised, I'll pray your immune system's not compromised. For my safe existence trumps your resistance. Let's be among the ones who test negative. And if you should survive to 105, look at all you'll derive out of being alive. And here is the best part, you have a head start. If you mask and wash your hands and stay apart.
The only time negativity is a positive, right?
That's right. That's absolutely right. All right. Are we ready to bring my other Dan back in, my Danielle?
Absolutely. Let's put him on the hot seat.
All right. I got triple Dan's.
Right. Edie, was that you singing bass?
That was Dan singing bass, and then I was the little backup singers. And I made that on Logic Pro. You know, I just made the track, and then we did the video and everything. And it's funny. All those viral videos from early pandemic, most of them hold up. You know, I look at it and I think, oh, I would have changed this editing or that editing, but you know what? I wouldn't change a thing. I'm so glad that we did that.
We've gotten a lot of mileage out of it.
Really have. Sadly, but also that's great, right? It's so great. So now we're going to get mileage out of a little bit of text because I'm going to make Daniel Shigo play Sounds Like a Song. Daniel Shigo, are you ready?
Yes.
All right, Dan Chaika, I'm going to put you in the green room. I'll be back in a minute. All right, Daniel Shigo, I promise it will only hurt a minute. Then it won't hurt anymore. All right, and love won't hurt anymore. Okay, so what we do is we find something that starts in the chat. Now, viewers, if you're watching right now and you would like to put something into the chat for Daniel to sing, give him a phrase of a song that hasn't been written yet. My job is to give him the music, and his job is just to start singing. So what we do is, as an example, here is what Dan wrote. We thrive on failure. So we're going to make that the first song we do is called We Thrive on Failure. So somewhere you work that into the song, all right, wherever you want. And I'll give you something super easy to start with, okay? Let's see.
I was walking down the street, didn't ever think we'd meet, but we did, and then we married. That was 5 years ago. Oh my God, we thrive on failure.
That did not go where I thought it was going to go.
How was that?
That's perfect. How long have you been married?
28.
Okay. This is not your husband. This is somebody else. Just making that clear.
This is an imaginary person.
Okay, good.
I'm an actor. I'm acting.
Okay, he's acting. Remember that. Husband, he's acting. It's just acting, right? Take my wife, please.
And that was sort of like Motown-y.
You're right, it was. Okay, the pipes in the basement burst. Shirley has one. The pipes in the basement burst. All right, so.
Sorry, I'm thinking.
Go ahead and think.
20 years ago, you've never seen it go away. The water and the sludge, the picture and the drudge, the pipes that burst in the basement. The pipes that burst in the basement.
The pipes that burst in the basement.
The sludge never goes away.
The sludge. The sludge, it never goes away.
And then the whistle goes.
Yes! Yes! Sondheim is in wherever he is going, no.
That was terrible.
Right. He'd say, no, concise. Oh, do you have these books?
I do not.
Right.
I've got these.
I hold them up like Moses holding up the Ten Commandments.
I've got volume 1 and 2.
Yeah,
those
are good.
I've got the bass baritone book.
Yes.
I've got the duet book.
Uh-huh. This is good. They're good. See, Sondheim lovers have a lot of Sondheim around. So this is his collected writing.
Yeah.
Talking about how he wrote his musical scores.
That's
so
cool.
The first one, Finishing the Hat, and then Look, I Made a Hat. And you read these, and then you can't write anything for like a while because nothing is good enough. So, but they're wonderful books.
Yeah.
And he tells a lot of great stories about, you know, Elaine and Patty and everybody. So it's awesome. Oh, okay. More people are writing stuff in. Okay. Here is, it's 36 degrees. I'm about to freeze. From Larry. Okay.
Oh my gosh.
You bet.
It's 36 degrees. And I'm about to freeze in Manhattan.
That sounds like it.
It's 36 degrees, and I'm about to freeze in your bed.
You want to be in Barcelona.
Barcelona.
It's warm in Barcelona.
Not Corona.
But it's 36 degrees in Manhattan. Does anyone still wear a hat? That joke still works.
It totally does.
It still works. It will never not work as long as you just know where to do it. So thank you, Larry. That was awesome. That started in a Sweeney place. It ended in a company place.
Yes.
I'm totally here for that. So yeah, Daniel and I agreed. We didn't agree. We just did it. That all the improv tonight is Sondheim based. And if you need to know, that's actually not that easy to do.
It's kind of terrifying, actually.
Yeah, you have to know a lot of Sondheim to actually be able to pull that off.
I'm like, rhymes, but aren't too obvious.
Right, but not too obvious, because Sondheim. Yeah. And so trying to edit that at the same time, there is actually like a couple of music improv groups in the United States that improv in a Sondheim style.
I can't imagine.
It's really funny. And what was it, Jeff Harner, cabaret singer based in New York, right? I just went to Feinstein's in November and saw his fabulous show, all about Sondheim, called I Know Things Now, which I think is coming to Chicago. There, Jeff, I'm giving you a shameless plug. And in it, he did a parody of Oklahoma done in a style, like a Sondheim style. And it was screamingly funny. So Sondheim does have his musical tropes that are super funny. Okay, here's one more. Okay, when COVID goes away, we will play. When COVID goes away, we will play.
When COVID goes away, we will play canasta. When COVID goes away, we will play in time. Discast canasta doesn't rhyme.
Who has time for canasta? We've got a good thing going with canasta. See what I mean?
I can't think of a rhyme. A canasta.
If you ask your asta, it will say, play canasta. There, we'll end on the F.
That was fun. It started out okay.
Yep. It started out with canasta. And then it worked into something about your ass. But then we had to go on.
That's pretty good.
Thank you. Thank you. It's the Chardonnay. All right. Okay. Oh, this is going to hurt. This is going to hurt. What rhymes with Sondheim?
Sondheim a long time.
Yeah, Sondheim a long time. Good. And actually, our
Forgone
friend,
time.
Our friend Karen O'Connor has here pasta, which is really pronounced, but canasta, pasta, right? That's good. That's good. Karen,
canasta,
you're going to come on.
Canasta. You got to do it like you got to do it from like Brooklyn. Canasta, pasta.
Right. Jackie's packy.
Canasta, she was past to date. She had no due date. She was past to date.
Past to due date. Okay. What rhymes with Sondheim? Okay. What rhymes with Sondheim?
Long time.
Long time. All right. Let's see. What kind of a
fun time?
Yeah. I'm paging my brain of like different Sondheim things I can put in here. Oh, I haven't done this one yet. Okay.
Which one are we doing?
We're going to do what rhymes with Sondheim.
Okay.
Yep. What rhymes with Sondheim?
From a long time.
We miss you, Stephen Sondheim.
Where did you go? No one can know.
Oh, that's good. That's freaking good. We would have liked that.
If it was right that
at the juncture of the rhyme is where he spent time.
Never you mind.
Never you,
you mind.
You want to keep going?
Sure.
All right, bridge. Just when we thought
everything ends,
we have to sing another part of this song
until we bend.
Making it up as we go along,
it's in our usual way. It wasn't great. Then we went away. This is so fun.
Your fault, I fear.
I can't believe the time went away. Oh, my dear.
But thank you, Daniel.
Thank you, my queen. I know you are seen.
Oh my gosh. Yes. Oh, Dan's taking.
You were the queen of your own Casteel.
I'm the queen of my own Casteel. My own Casteel, that's right. Queen of the Casteel.
That's where I thought I was doing.
Okay, there, I'm following you. That's Once Upon a Mattress. We could do that too. So, but that's a totally different one. All right, so Sondheim is smiling. I hope so. I really hope so. Because we've really done a number on his songs tonight. But that's so fun. He has so much good stuff. So you get to do one more. I think we should do the last one on our list, Daniel.
Which
one? And
that'll
be our kind of closeout. The one that's the duet.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, let's do that. So we're going to give you one more before we're out. And this one is kind of a great way of thinking about the year coming up. You know, there's a lot going on, but we hope it's a good year for all of you.
This is such a great tune.
Right, there's a hole in my mask. So we'll have Daniel back on, and he can do a whole hour of improvised Sondheim. Wouldn't that be fun? Right, yeah, absolutely. But thank you, Julia. She says that one was really sweet. It was.
That
really
was actually kind of worked.
Yeah, kind of worked. It kind of worked. So now this is from Anyone Can Whistle, right? And this is With So Little to Be Sure Of, right? I don't even know what key I'm in anymore.
With so little to be sure. If there's anything at all, if there's anything at all, I'm sure of here and now and us together. All I'll ever be high. If there's anything to be, being sure enough of you makes me sure enough of me. Thanks for everything we did. Everything that's past. Everything that's over too fast. None of it was wasted. All of it will last. Everything that's here and now and us together. It was marvelous to know you, and it isn't really through crazy business this life we live in. Don't complain about the time we're given, with so little to be sure of in this world. We had a marvelous moment.
A marvelous moment. I need you more than I can say. I need you more than just one day. I guess I need you more than you.
The more I memorize your face,
if there's anything to be,
the more I never want to leave.
Being sure enough of you, make me sure enough of me.
Come with me,
thanks for everything we did.
There's more of love in me right now than all the little bits
that's
of
love I've known too fast. None of it was wasted.
None of it was wasted.
All of it will last.
All of it will last. Everything that's here and now and us
together.
It was marvelous to know you. And it's never. Crazy business, this life we live in. Can't complain about the time we're given. We're so little to be sure of it.
Me right now, Daniel. Thank you so much.
That was fun.
That was fun. I feel like we should have a cigarette. Thank you so much, Daniel Shigo, for being a guest on The Eden Show. So
thank you for inviting me.
DAN CHAIKA, thank you so much. Keep healing. And I will see you all next week on January 13th with Beth Barron, guitarist, who will be joining us virtually as well. So we will see you all then. Thank you so much for tuning in. Please subscribe, buy coffees, go visit Daniel's website, shigovoicelessons.com. Did I get it right?
You did.
Right there. So there's so much to look at over there. I loved crawling over your website. It's really, really fun. So have a good night, everybody. Happy New Year, and we will see you next week. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Good night.
Let me put on my little graphics here, because I got to say, oh, let me do this. I've got, look at this. I've got to roll credits. Look at this.